calm at last. This is Bahia Potrero at 10 degrees 25 minutes north and 85 degrees 45 minutes west, our first landfall in Costa Rica. After getting kicked around by El Papagayo, we thought this would be the perfect place for a little well-deserved R&R. We pulled the windsurfer off the deck and went out for a little practice. If you're beginners like we are, try to stick to onshore wind conditions and use a flat, well-protected bay. If there's more than 5 to 8 knots of breeze, you may as well just hang it up. There's an American community here. They're building some homes and a couple little hotels and restaurants. There's a bar up there on that hill. That's the first place we went. Bill, the dockmaster, drives that little white truck there. He'll come down and sell you some diesel if you need it. We're flying the quarantine flag because we hadn't cleared customs yet. We had a zarpe from Mexico with our complete crew list. With the flag up, we're under pratique, which means that technically we couldn't go ashore, but they're pretty lax about it here at Potrero. We headed northeast 11 miles to Playa de Coco to clear customs so that we'd be in the country legally and everything would be fine. As it turned out, everything wasn't fine. In mid-1985, there still weren't any visa forms in Playa de Coco. So we learned the hard way something we'd like to pass on to you. If you plan to visit Costa Rica by boat, get your visas in the United States before you leave. This will save you a long, uncomfortable bus ride to the capital for paperwork. Aside from this little hitch, we'd have to say that Costa Rica is just about the nicest little country on earth. The president of Costa Rica travels around with just his driver and is safe and welcome in any city or village he chooses to visit. Fish and lobster are abundant in coastal waters, and a wide variety of fresh produce and meats can be had daily in the little markets. Rest assured that Uncle Sam has quietly but effectively insured Costa Rica against trouble from her northern neighbor, Nicaragua. This is Playa de Coco, a lovely calm bay and our home for the first 2 weeks of June. Playa de Coco is on the Gulf of Papagayo at 10 degrees 40 minutes north and 85 degrees 40 minutes west. The port captain is a lovely young lady named Liliana. She can check you in, grant you pratique, and steer you toward hard to find items in town. If she could only issue visas. For those, we got up early one morning and caught the 7:30 bus to San Jose.
After obtaining visas at the Airport Tourist Bureau, we rented a car and took in the sights of the city. We figured that if we got Panamanian visas from the embassy in San Jose, our entry to the canal zone would be easier and cheaper. We were right.
Okay, so here we are at the Panamanian consulate down in San Jose, Costa Rica, and we just got our visas. It was pretty simple, wasn't it, Paul?
Piece of cake. Already stamped the passports and everything. Didn't cost us a dime. We should be able to go right on through the canal.
San Jose is a modern, busy city with a full complement of MD steakhouses. While we were there, we found out how seriously the Costa Ricans take their soccer.
We're not quite sure what's going on down here in the street, but a large crowd is gathered. There are some folks waving flags, and from somewhere we can hear a loud speaker.
If you're so inclined, the nightlife can be quite exciting in San Jose. Our hotel was right downtown and cost about $24 for a double. We found an excellent French restaurant and dined out for the first time in 6 weeks. We also took in a movie and saw Beverly Hills Cops, subtitled in Spanish. Eddie Murphy is a funny dude in any language. First of all, I want to say that we're here on Cosmic Dancer. It's a boat we've all been concerned about because you've been missing for quite a while, according to some of the folks around here, and us included. What happened to you?
Well, I wasn't missing because I was in the Pacific. I knew exactly where I was in the Pacific Ocean, you know, sailing down from Mexico to Costa Rica. My motor failed, and for several days there was no wind. I was becalmed, totally becalmed. The Pacific was like a mirror. And then I get wind, and when I got wind, it was usually in the wrong direction. I couldn't make easterly, and I was at that time 125 miles from shore, so I had to make easterly. But you know, you just cannot choose your weather, and it took that long. And then I was hit by lightning, and all the instruments went out, all the electricity, totally. The battery were totally drained. There was no log, there was no time, no radio, no nothing. I got knocked down too. I got everything.
But you're saying that the masts were parallel to the surface of the water?
That's right. That's exactly what it was.
Where did you end up?
Well, I did go into the coast of Nicaragua something like 50 miles north of the border. I did talk to some army guys who came out in Pangas, but there was no provision available. Right after that, I ran into this American spy ship, which goes up and down the Nicaraguan coast, and they gave me food and water. And that solved the problem, so then I knew I could make it to Costa Rica, you know. I learned a lot on this trip. I learned a lot about the boat, about the ocean, and a bit about myself. It's not an experience which scares you as such. You really come out feeling better for it when you're through it.
Well, we've done about everything we can to get ready for the rain. It's not even in the United States where in the summer it clouds up in the afternoon and you get some thunderstorms. I mean, it really rains here, so you've got to be prepared for that. If you come here from June through November, December, you're going to get wet. It's hot and muggy, and it rains. It rains all the time. Of course, if you're boating, you'll have no shortage of fresh water, which is a problem cruising down off Mexico most of the year. It's dry. I kind of like it.
The tide goes way up and the sky gets real dark. Each day at a certain time in the afternoon it starts raining, and each day that time gets a little earlier until pretty soon it's raining constantly. If you're headed for the canal, it's best to get there before June 1st. We got pretty good at staying dry. We used an old dinghy cover lashed over the dodger to keep the middle seam from leaking. We turned the Zodiac over to catch rainwater for drinking. And then we just waited for it to rain.
The storms continued and worsened as we made our way southeast. If you feel blasé about electrical storms at sea, look at the charts of the coast and count up the offshore dangers you'll have to contend with between Playa de Coco and the canal. We took on diesel at Potrero and headed for Panama. The canal was still about 700 miles away. At times, we ran our jumper cables dangling in the water to affect some sort of lightning rod. I highly recommend it for your emotional well-being, if nothing else. We also disconnected the antenna lead to the VHF radio to keep it from getting blown up. Our first stop after leaving Coco was Boca de Piedra Blanca, a miserable but welcome anchorage at 9 degrees 50 minutes north and 85 degrees 25 minutes west. We arrived at night with good satellite fixes, accurate charts in hand, and the radar cooking. I guess it was just as well that we couldn't see these breakers on approach, because it probably would have discouraged us from entering the bay at all. There aren't many anchorages between Potrero and Golfito that offer protection from the westerly swell, so you take what you can get. We skipped Punta Arenas, a good idea unless you really need repairs. Mosquitoes and high prices seem to be the norm, although Punta Arenas is well protected. We anchored next at Quepos, 9 degrees 25 minutes north and 84 degrees 10 minutes west, and still 560 miles from the canal. Again, not much protection from the swell, but it's a picturesque little community, and there are lots of cheap lobster to be had from the local fishermen. Two nights after leaving Quebos, we ran through some of the most intense electrical storms of the entire trip. We wore our sunglasses on night watch to keep from being blinded by the lightning. Thankfully, we reached Golfito without being hit. Unlike the rest of Costa Rica, Golfito has excellent navets left over from the United Fruit Company's better days in the banana business. We crossed the 3,000-mile mark entering Golfito at 8 degrees 40 minutes north and 83 degrees 10 minutes west. Like everywhere else in Costa Rica, the people are friendly here and very helpful. Don't bother with checking in if you're here on a weekend, but do take the time to visit Captain Tom's restaurant and bar in his shipwreck hotel. That's it on the beach. Tom declined to go before the camera for posterity, so you'll have to take our word for it that he's a legend in his own time. Be sure to sign his guest book. Golfito is a good place to have a look at the tide charts for the Pacific entrance to the Panama Canal. There is a 12 to 20 foot tide there daily and lots of shoaling near the Balboa Yacht Club, your likely destination. Remember, there's international shipping from all over the Pacific headed for the canal just as you are, so stay alert as you approach Punta Mala. There are also beautiful islands off the coast of Panama worth exploring in good weather. However, Isla Coiba and Isla Jicaron are penal colonies. Don't anchor near these islands after dark.
Oh. Good morning.
Good morning.
Where are we?
We're in the Panama Canal. All we had to do was sail between all these red and green lights down here and stay out of the way of the big ships. We're a long way from Kansas, Toto.
The quarantine flag is up since this is our first stop in Panama. You'll need to dig up the customs and immigration authorities, two sets, Panamanian and U.S., and be sure to present your zarpe to the port captain. The Balboa Yacht Club gave us a mooring right off can 14 and a half at the entrance to the canal. Remember that shoaling we mentioned and be sure to pass 14 and a half before you turn in for your mooring. Customs may want to board your boat here, so take a minute to ensure that you're in order below. Your boat will need to be admeasured if it's never been through the canal so they can determine the fee. The yacht club charges $15 for temporary membership and $17.50 per day for mooring. As a transient, you'll only be allowed on the fuel dock Monday through Friday, so plan accordingly if you need water or diesel. You can only go ashore in the club launch. A toot of the whistle will call the driver, usually.
You will have to take a cab into Panama City for provisions and laundry.
We were able to make some reasonable deals and get a few errands done in different places by paying the driver per hour, which averaged $8 or $10 an hour.
There is also a duty-free shop behind the port captain's office that transient mariners are allowed to use. You'll find watches, stereos, perfume, liquor, and clothes at duty-free prices. We took the opportunity to load up on Heineken at $10 a case.
Since the Blimey Limey has been through the canal before, there is a record of her admeasure in the computer here. So it costs $35 for our 37-ton catch to transit the canal. They also hit us with a $30 Panama Waters cruising permit. Schedule your transit as soon as possible to avoid the yacht club's tab from getting too steep. Once you have completed all your paperwork, you'll be assigned a pilot advisor to guide you through the canal. He won't steer, but he will expect lunch.
Hi, my name is Mario. Mario Ayala. I'm a mate trainee on tugboats for Pan Canal, and as part of my training, I take yachts through 65 foot or under. We came on board, I check your lines, check your cleats, make sure we have all those 400 foot lines we're supposed to have,
right.
Plus your line handlers, and I counted them already. We have been assigned to transit with North 11, one of the larger freighters that are transiting through today.